Hello and welcome to the third video in the series Understanding Assessment Objectives in English Literature AS and A2. In this video we're going to be looking at Assessment Objective 2. This assessment objective focuses on your ability to use literary skills, that is using literary techniques and understanding, to analyse texts closely and show a good understanding of what authors intended when they were writing their poems, plays, or novels. Assessment Objective 2 focuses on showing your critical understanding, that's using those technical terms, analysing a range of texts, so that's looking at plays, poetry, drama, non-fiction, fiction, and so on. It's just talking about how they work and why they've been written in the way they have. And then analysing and evaluating, that's weighing up, how the writer's use of structure, form, and language shape the meanings within these texts and create impressions and ideas in the mind of the reader. As I said before, as you can see here as well, examiners are really, really concerned that candidates understand the difference between poetry, prose, and drama. You should know these by now anyway if you're embarking on AS or A2 courses, because you'd have learned it in GCSE. Poetry obviously is verse, that can be blank verse, sonnets, odes, epics, and so on. Prose is written in paragraphs and often involves reported speech, so it's novels, short stories, journals, recounts, travelogue, and so on. And drama, which is written in scripts. It's important that you understand these areas and why writers use different techniques within the different genres. Understanding, it also means you have to build on the knowledge that you gained at GCSE. So it's no good just reading these things and pointing out, oh, there's a simile, there's a metaphor and so on, or the writer has used personification here. You've got to have a deeper understanding of how they work within the form, why the author has used them, what effects they were trying to create, how it reflects upon their ideas and philosophy, how they're trying to influence their reader and so on. So there's a lot of deep understanding that you need to gain, and you need to be able to learn how to analyse these texts when you're shown them. Some of the AS and A2 courses, they give you unseen texts. So they expect you to use this AO2 skill very well and in depth, and then use AO1, which I talked about in the previous video, to express this understanding and analysis. AO2, examiners identify three major problems. So first of all, this often happens in coursework when students are asked to compare pieces, or in essays in under exam conditions when they're supposed to compare two poems, for example, or poems by the same author, or they're given unseen writing and are meant to, using their synoptic skills, that's the skills they've learned over the whole of their course, able to analyse a whole range of texts, prose, poetry and drama. So the first problem that they indicate is that candidates respond to the text in a narrative way, just telling the story, telling the examiner exactly what's already happened in the story. You're not being asked to write a summary. You're being asked to analyse, say how and why these things are there, why they've been done. They have problems with technical terminology. It's not just metaphors and similes, but also the language of grammar, the actual technical language that identifies what's going on in language, stylistics and so on. If these terms are strange to you, that means you need to go away and identify the different areas where you've got a lack of knowledge. But mostly your teachers will show you how to understand the way that language is used. You must keep notes and you must keep up. The whole idea then is to not play spot to the term. And some candidates have problems identifying and analysing uses of form and structure. Why, for example, use a sonnet? Why the 14 lines? Why in the rhyme scheme? Why the run-on lines? Why the breaks in the middle of the line? Why has the poet done this? You need to be able to link your understanding of the themes and content of the piece of writing you're looking at to the actual devices used by the author. In responses, they can tend to be too narrative. There's no analysis. You're not telling the examiner or your teacher how or why something's been done. You're just retelling the plot, retelling the story, talking about characters as if they're real people. That is basically a U at AS and A2. You need to build on your understanding of what you gained at GCSE. And then, of course, you can't explore or analyse if you don't link what's been written to the author's intentions. What was the author trying to do? How does it link to its time? Here we have AO2 linking very much to AO3 and AO4. AO3 is a comparison between texts, and AO4 is its context, when it was written, how it reflects the thoughts and feelings of the people who wrote it at that particular time, and how that links to our time now. Again, returning to this idea of terminology, just pointing out features, not explaining how they work, not analysing their use of personification and why it was done, what it was meant to reveal, the layers of meaning. And then finally, not understanding the form and structure of the different genres. Why are stage directions and stagecraft used in certain dramas? Why is rhyme used in certain poems? Why does an author use an ellipsis at the end of a paragraph? If you don't understand the structure, you won't be able to analyse it, you won't be able to employ AO2. Below then, we have an A example of AO2. I've taken this out. It obviously uses other assessment objectives, for example, AO1, the ability to write critically, coherently and clearly, like I talked about in the last video. So again, here we have it. This paragraph again begins with a good discourse marker, comparing one paragraph with the next, and it's talking about Shakespeare's play As You Like It and the relationship between Orlando and Rosalind. So here, we're talking about Shakespeare's intentions, linking it to the model of the drama, linking it to actually, and here we got AO2 moving into AO3, comparison with other texts, linking it to a convention that informs the play itself, the pastoral and the love poem. There is a clear, deep analysis of the use of language and how that language is exaggerated in the fantasized classical world. And again, technical language here is employed to explain Shakespeare's intentions. It's not here to just be listed. So the candidate does not write just about rhetorical and elevated language and leaves it, but actually links it to the intentions of the writer and links it to the conventions of the drama and its particular theme here, the pastoral idyll. Finally, the candidate quotes a critical source which shows their particular understanding of AO2 in its depth, because here in AO2 you are also meant to take into account other people's readings, other academics' readings, other writers' readings of a particular form of writing. And here we have it again. And it links in, again, using AO1, links in very well with the quotation, links in very well with the point that's made at the beginning of the paragraph, and reinforces their argument and evaluates their argument by talking about this idea of a conscious artifice. Note the high-level language, basically talking about that Shakespeare was conscious of the fact and very well aware that he was using language that might seem a little bit out of its time and old-fashioned, in order to show that he's representing a world that's not completely realistic. So you can see then, AO2 really is important. It supports AO1 and the rest of the AOs. AO2 is essential for answering questions on unseen poetry, prose and drama. It's essential in understanding authors' intentions, and it's essential in building your response to any question about how a writer has gone about producing a play, a poem, or a novel.